before we get started today, I wanted to share a little story around the evolution of this topic. My wife wanted a camera that could take great pictures in the school gymnasium and zoom in on the moving action of the wrestler, specifically her son, all in a compact design that would fit into her purse. Oh yeah, and one I could afford as well. Sounds simple enough, but as an experienced photographer, I knew that she was looking for the perfect camera that does not exist. We all have to make sacrifices and trade-offs, both as consumers and manufacturers of products. So let's get started and explore the four common limitations of escaping the perfect product trap. Pursuing perfection through innovation is a good thing, but is it attainable without some limitations or possible risk? No matter what type of product you're attempting to create, a camera, a car, a medical device, a plane, or a software application, most seek perfection or strong differentiation in the respective markets. Most of us want our products to work flawlessly with the highest quality, as well as your stakeholders and investors. As you start to innovate with new concepts and better designs that differentiate your product in your market, you'll likely be faced with some of these limitations. To better manage these limitations, the product complexity usually rises as well, which can increase risk for potential hazards, especially if your potential markets are large. When risk and hazards increase, especially in public health, typically there are government regulations or international standards that advocate enforcing good processes and mandate quality measures are in place. Don't let this limit your creativity for innovation of the perfect product or highest quality product. Most regulatory agencies want assurance you have, you know, really thought through all your possible risk and you actually manage all these assets. Traceability is usually their way of saying a link or a relationship needs to exist so there is reduced risk or visibility if change happens. You ultimately need to be able to defend why and how you develop with quality in mind. If you're pursuing perfection or differentiation, marketing and legal will also want to substantiate any specific claims or differentiation. Most limitations are discussed or explored in the earliest phases of product research. Unfortunately, most are not documented well. No product or project is without some form of limitation or constraint. As you move forward with greater innovation and differentiation with your product, there will likely be more internal and external limitations imposed. Understanding your limitations will help you ensure that proper checks and balances are in place. Most products and projects have at least one limitation in the following four areas. Whether you're limited by business, user, operational, or environmental factors, companies must capture, track, and trace key data or limitations to help lower overall risk. Some companies manage these limitations within their product and specification and requirement documents, but is it really done when they're first discovered or discussed?
You're absolutely right, Larry. All projects have some form of limitation, but I think today we're going to be looking at those limitations a little bit differently than what a lot of companies do, because when we hear the word limitation, many times we think of a negative connotation, and those limitations can have positive effects on our products that we develop for our customers. The big things that we need to consider here are, first of all, we need to recognize what those limitations are, and we want to make sure that we document those. And once the limitations are identified and documented, the next thing that we want to do is to analyze those and make sure that they are not going to adversely affect our products.
Before we get started into the four common limitations, let's look at the perfect product question, which was posed to all of you on the call when you registered. 58% had indicated that it was not attainable, while 9% indicated that Apple iProducts, such as the iPad, iPhone, iPod, and OS, believe it's the perfect product. The third best response was our own product, Test Track. Fourth multi-response was for Google applications such as Gmail. The other 25% with one response represented the rest, so they were all unique responses, you know, possibly just to get through the registration process. But just to read a couple responses off to you, my personal favorite, a banana, bottled water,
Really, Larry? Bottled water? Not even sparkling water?
No, just bottled water.
Wow.
Dev Studio. My second favorite was a key copier at Walmart. Now, I've had keys made there, and only to get home and find they didn't fit my locks and had to go back. Netflix, let's hope the internet doesn't go down. Nutribullet, PayPal, Picasa, Samsung Galaxy, Swatch, the Toyota Prius. But didn't they just have a recall earlier this year?
I'm not sure if they had a recall, Larry, but I do know that you can get 40 bags of mulch in a Prius. I did that once. Make sure it's a rental, though. I wouldn't do it with my own.
Yeah, I'm sure in the limitation section it exceeded capacity. And then finally, X year. Since I don't believe we're going to get a consensus decision on the perfect product, let's explore the four common limitations we need to consider. Business limitations. While it would be nice to have unlimited budget and timelines, every company has these limitations. These business limitations can limit the amount of talent and resources available to deliver the product within a specific timeline. Even if your company had unlimited budget, are the materials or technology advanced enough to support your user requirements?
Larry, you're absolutely right. You know, I certainly believe that we all understand budgets and not unlimited, and we don't have unlimited time. But it's almost like you actually followed my career here. I had an opportunity some years ago, before I started working here at Seapine, to manage a project. And one of the things that they told me early on in order to get me to accept it was the parameters were, it was a 3-year project. This was the final year, and the previous project manager had left for another job. There was supposed to be a $2 million budget. Sounded good, and I had an existing team. So on the surface, everything seemed great until I showed up the first day. And when I showed up, one of the things that I found initially was that the existing team had 5 developers, a single DBA, but we had no testers. Now, I'm not sure how, if you're developing software that you're going to turn over, that you can do that without having any testers on board. We also had 2 senior Java developers. Unfortunately, one of those guys decided to take another position closer to home shortly after I arrived. And as I started looking at the personnel that we had, I found out very quickly that initially, we were using a different development methodology, and we were moving to Java. And of the developers we had, only 2 of them were Java developers. So we were going to have some shortfalls with the learning on the job. We also had a senior Java developer that had been hired recently, but unfortunately, they were not functioning at the senior Java developer level. So there were some problems with the personnel that we had. When I started taking a look at the budget, unfortunately, the $2 million that we were supposed to have, there were some cost overruns on the first 2 phases, and we were already down to $1.4 million that all of this stuff had to get out the door for in a year without even any testers on board. So you can see here that even though we've listed all of these different business limitations, I actually had all of those on one particular product. I had certainly some issues with my internal and external resources. The technology that we were using, we were not up to speed with using that technology, and we were going to have some time and money constraints based on the budget issues that I discovered after I had arrived.
Anthony, that's a great example of business limitations, and part of your story directly points back to resources, more specifically around skill sets. Let's look at our second limitation, which is centered around user or customer limitations. Unfortunately, there is no such thing as the perfect user or operator of a product. While we all want the perfect photographer, driver, surgeon, pilot, or engineer, the reality is there are potential user limitations, that may affect how you target your intended user. We're all different, so while it may be a perfect product to one user, it may not be for another. We all invest time and money into human factors engineering to attempt to make the user's experience as intuitive as possible in software development. Unfortunately, intuitiveness of a product is somewhat subjective. Just try to find one product on the internet where nobody has ever complained or wanted to improve it in some way. There are also other culture and political user aspects that may require attention, which can cause other limitations to your product design, such as language.
You know, Larry, in and of itself, a lot of unique factors are not necessarily a bad thing. The real issue with these unique factors is to make sure that we analyze those items and document them so that we can use those to develop additional requirements. Now, I've been to an amusement park, and probably some of the people online have been to an amusement park in the past as well. And one of the things that I noticed when I took my kids there is that there's always the little guys that are walking up after they get into the park to see if they are tall enough to be able to ride all of the big roller coasters in the park. And if you've seen that, you can see that sometimes the kids have big smiles on their faces and they're jumping up and down because this is the first opportunity to ride those coasters. And then other times you see the sad faces that they're going to have to wait another month or maybe even another year before they're able to get on those rides. Just last year, though, I saw something I had never seen before. You know what that was, Larry?
What?
Well, there was a gentleman, he was pretty tall because I saw him when he came in with his friend over the top of everybody else. And the people at the ride told him that he couldn't ride it because he was actually too tall. I'd never run into that before, and I think most of us think when we pass that line where we can actually get on the roller coaster that we'll always be able to ride it. But if you think about it for a minute, when people are developing those roller coasters, one of the things that they have to do is to determine what the parameters are going to be for the roller coaster to actually run. So when we look at it that the little kids can't get on, I think everybody accepts that. But when we see that somebody that is too tall, it's not something that we've thought about, but the engineers actually have. They had to think about all of those things up front to understand with the safety harnesses and all the safety devices that they were going to use if they were going to fit for the average person.
I bet that guy really wanted to see a max height so he didn't stand in line the whole time. That's what I'd be upset about.
Well, they did come and get him out of the middle of the line, but he did stand there for at least 30 minutes.
Oh, that's tough. Great story, Anthony. I think we can all relate to. Let's look at our third limitation, which are centered around operational limitations from a compliance, quality, and safety. You know, depending on what industry you're in and how your product is marketed, you may be required to follow specific guidelines or regulations from government agencies or even international standards. This is not always a limitation, but more of a best practice to ensure good management processes, linking, analysis, and testing is performed and, of course, documented. An automated and integrated solution should help solve this as it will provide insight and visibility to the processes. Many companies also invest into this operational quality processes, even if they're not governed, like Seapine is an example, so they can demonstrate safety and security with their clients. If your clients or even your target markets are regulated, you really better know or be able to defend a similar quality processes as they usually expect, you know, the same from their vendors as well.
You know, Larry, I don't really look at the operational limitations as being new to companies. Companies that have been developing products know this all the time. And this is actually an opportunity that you can use to use those regulations, guidelines, and standards to provide some new requirements that you can make sure that you're adhering to as you're going through that development process. That way you can make sure that you're meeting all of the safety guidelines and quality items that are required for your particular industry. Now, all of these different, I'm seeing some things here that I don't recognize, Larry. What is TMATR? I'm not familiar with that.
It's actually one I created for this webinar. It stands for too many acronyms to remember, which is a sad reality when trying to get your head around all the regulatory guidelines and standards out there. You know, keeping them current with these standards is yet another struggle, as they can change actually as well. So let's look at our fourth and final limitation that we're going to explore today, which is you know, fortunately, we can design products that operate within ideal ranges that are safe if we communicate these ranges or tolerance levels, like temperature, humidity, and other environmental factors. If you're working with chemicals or other potential hazardous materials, they can raise your limitations from environmental impact. If you outsource or include third-party suppliers like batteries, verification testing will likely be your responsibility to validate it against its intended use.
You know, Larry, I've had my new cell phone for about 7 months now. You know how I know how long I've had my cell phone?
No.
Because I can base how my cell phone performs, the battery itself, based on how long I've had it. My experience with cell phones has been that about 18 months after I have the cell phone, the battery for my mobile phone is probably about 30 minutes, 15 minutes on a bad day. And I look forward to that 2 years when I can actually change that phone. I get so frustrated with the batteries. And I was actually sold on this particular phone because the gentleman that I was speaking with told me that this battery was so far advanced than the last one that I had that you can't even take it out of the phone. And I actually bought it, Larry. I went with it. I'm hoping now that it lasts for more than 2 years, but I started thinking about it, and it really didn't make sense. I talked to a friend of mine, and he actually has a medical device that's been implanted in him. Can you imagine if you had a medical device and you had to go back to the doctor and get an operation every time you had to get the battery
updated? That's why I don't go to the doctor.
Well, okay.
That's another problem.
Well, he told me that the battery that he had would last for about 3 months, and when it needed to be charged, it would let him know that it needed to charge, and he would have this belt with a little contraption on it where he'd have to sit in his house for about 3 hours. It would charge the battery up, and he would be good to go for another 2 to 3 months. I wish I had something like that for my cell phone.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have to change it every 2 years.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind having that. Speaking of the perfect product, you know, if you had a belt like that, it, you know, could really, you know, look good. I could charge my iPhone. I wouldn't have to really worry about it because, you know, trying to remember to constantly, you know, plug it in usually goes out at the most inopportune times.
Well, I wouldn't think that's a perfect product because I don't use iPhones, Larry.
Oh. Well, 9% of the audience does because based on their perfect product responses.
Well, there's only 9%. 91% didn't say that. So I would say 91% are siding with me that the iPhone is not a perfect product.
Yeah. Well, how about a similar belt that charges my camera batteries, and I know we're putting on batteries a bit here, but I've definitely noticed how fast my Nikon batteries drain when taking them, you know, outdoor pictures in Alaska versus Hawaii. I can stay out all day in Hawaii where the same exact battery may only last for a few hours in the cold in Alaska.
But really, can't everybody stay out a little longer in Hawaii, Larry, than they could in Alaska? You probably just want to get back inside where it's warm, wouldn't you?
No, I get out there with them. So let's look at a few questions to kind of ask ourselves. You know, these limitations or constraints are not always negative. They just need to be managed and communicated appropriately, as they potentially could introduce risk or hazards to your business users or okay. Our environment. So here are four questions that we have up that you should ask yourself when thinking of limitations. Clearly, nobody wishes these upon themselves, which is why, you know, it's so important to understand these things. Even a near-perfect product has limitations, but effectively managing and communicating these limitations can help reduce your risk.
You know, Larry, I really like this example here, but you know, I recently had an opportunity to take a look at the gaming industry, and you're probably thinking the gaming industry in Vegas, but I'm actually talking about the computer gaming industry. And one of the things that I think that we've all realized but not really said is that these games seem to come out about Christmas time.
Yeah, my son's it's the time. He always wants the latest and the greatest game, and it always comes out at that time. So.
Yeah, I talked to a gentleman that works at one of those gaming companies, and you know, he told me that they always know that they their market is such that they have to come out with those games around the Thanksgiving time. And if they miss that date, then they know that they're going to either miss a large market opportunity or it's going to cost the company a lot of money. So the limitation of having to get the games out every year based on this particular date is not necessarily looked at as a bad thing for them. They look at that as a way to manage the structure of their time and to make sure that they are going to meet that deadline and get the game out on time. Let's take a look now at how limitations may evolve. Now, we've all seen or heard of the drone program. We heard of it mostly when we were at war, and nobody paid much attention to what the drone program was actually doing at that time. But when the war was starting to wind down and people were looking at what can we do with this new technology, lots of companies sprung up. And one of the things that they were looking at is, can we use the drone program to help with border security? Or even can we use that drone program to help with law enforcement if they have to surveil different people for various things? Now, as soon as people heard surveillance, now there was an issue, and Congress is taking a look at how that might work. We're also taking a look at and putting new laws in place in order to govern that. But I actually saw recently that Amazon had said that they were thinking of being able to use drones to deliver products. And hey, I'm a big Amazon Prime user, and if I can order something online, Larry, and get it in a couple hours, I'm all for it.
Well, you know, when you were doing the research for this webinar, I went out to see about other evolutions of the drones, and I was happy to see they're considering using drones to deliver pizza. which I would.
Yeah, I'm on board with that.
I would really like it because they don't even deliver pizza to me.
You can't get pizza where you live at, Larry?
No, I
can't. Where do you live at? In the boonies?
Actually, I do, so.
Sorry.
So, we've kind of danced around the whole idea of limitations or directly or indirectly related to risk, but are we simply afraid to call them what they really are? In reviewing hundreds of high-level requirement documents, most have at least one form of limitation, constraint, or assumption section within those documents. Those who admit limitations, constraints, or risk-related usually are driven from an operational compliance perspective. However, a common issue is the tendency to overmanage or silo these risk assessments from daily usage downstream. A big question to ask yourself, are you managing the risk, or is it, you know, really managing you? Those who are, you know, admit the truth of these relationships and the evolution to risk and hazard is a matter of finding the right balance. Some people listening may believe that managing risk and hazards are only for, you know, regulated industries. But, you know, what about the other three limitations, business, user, or environmental?
You're absolutely right again, Larry. We're not really suggesting here that every company develop, you know, a formal risk plan doing FMEAs or FTAs. But more importantly, we want to make sure that you're sharing and capturing key data across your project so that you can determine if there are problems that might affect you later on in down the line.
The key takeaways today, and number one, capture data. Anthony, what data should we recommend to capture?
Well, that's a tough question, Larry, and there really is no perfect answer, as it's going to be different with really every business. The biggest thing is to explore with your data, to explore a data collection strategy that makes sense for your business. You can use products, components, and maybe even subcomponents to break down and organize the data. And this is also going to help you if an issue is found later on and you need to go back and find out what that information is. It can also help you with reuse if you're breaking your data down in that manner as well. When we're working on determining what data to capture, you also want to make sure that you're laying the foundation for any future analysis that you want to do as well. When we start looking at risk-related items can be as simple as identifying those potential limitations that we talked about earlier, or constraints, or any risk level which could trigger some more formal risk process. And lots of companies do that. They look at the risks that or limitations that they have, and depending on what the parameters are, there may be something there that triggers that they have to do some more digging in order to alleviate that particular risk. Now, as we discussed earlier today, we have four different limitations that could possibly affect your projects, both business, user, operational, and environmental items. And you want to make sure that you look at those limitations as well as precursors to risks that you may have with your products. Most regulated industries, just like you said, Larry, like medical device, use those formal FMEAs to help mitigate higher risk items by capturing severity, occurrence, and detection data, along with any additional relevant information that they feel is necessary for their particular products. Now, when you're associating or linking these mitigations directly to the requirements, it's going to help increase the visibility of the risk to the rest of the team. And that's one of the important things that I want to make sure that everybody understands here. When determining what type of testing data to collect, you'll probably find that there are known pieces of information, such as known units of measure or unit limits, already identified in your requirements, because a lot of those things are done up front. Now, if we manage these, they can greatly assist us in developing both sound test procedures and also good reusability with our products. Now, if those tolerance levels are written and known in the requirements phase, and if you're not automating this type of process in some fashion, you know, I would really challenge you, are you really willing to take the risk that somebody copied and pasted that data as part of the test procedure? Now, that to me sounds pretty risky. Mm-hmm. Most of the data is typically identified and captured in the requirements phase, which can give you either direct or indirect impact on the risks that you might have. Now, when we start looking at metrics, this is always a big topic for most companies. All of the information that we have talked about collecting up front at some point is going to come into play in the future. And those are the types of information that we're going to be using to develop our metrics from. If you have any operational limitations, you need to better understand the full scope of what is required in that particular industry. And just like the regulations that we talked about earlier, you could have regulations, guidelines, and standards, which can also help to drive what those metrics might be. Now, additionally, there are a lot of companies out there that may use some type of progress stages to manage the project or manage the risk. And it's more than just capturing the data, and I can't stress that enough. If you're just capturing the data and not doing anything with it, you're actually doing yourself a disservice. It's more than just capturing that data. You need to make sure that you're giving visibility to it to other members of the team, and you're also using that to calculate any key performance indicators that might alert you to problems in your development process.
So once we've captured data, how do we provide better visibility to it?
Well, it's not really any different, Larry, than the products that we're building. All that stuff which tells you what you need to build and when it may be due and what the internal and external compliance items might be, that's just a step-by-step approach. And that's the same thing that we want to take here in providing that visibility. Although you may not need a tool when you start out, probably as the complexity arises, and I think you alluded to this, Larry, things are going to grow out of control if you're using Word and Excel spreadsheets or either systems that don't talk to each other. And some of you on the call here may have already run into this. So improving your traceability is going to be one of the big keys in managing your risk process. It's the first step in getting things connected and making sure that you have a better understanding of the context of the relationships of the information that you're actually dealing with. You have to connect the dots. You have to go from your high-level requirements to your detailed requirements and then on to your tests. And you also need to make sure that you're doing that in an easy to understand format. You know, I would challenge people that are doing this in an Excel spreadsheet if that format that you're using is actually easy for someone else to understand. You also want to make sure that you're promoting better communication by not just identifying those subject matter experts. And I think everybody realizes that We have to have subject matter experts on the projects that we're working on, and we want to give them access to the relevant information across that project. But there could also be other people on your team which might not be a subject matter expert, and you can improve the products that you have if you also give an extra set of eyes on those requirements and on those tests to help drive that development effort. Now, this is not just a data collection activity, and I know I've been at some companies where they treat this as just a data collection activity. You really have to perform the analysis on the data that you're collecting. That's the way that you can determine if there are any potential impacts. If I'm going to change a requirement, what is going to be the impact of that particular change? So I want to take a look at all of the what-if scenarios before I actually go in and do something that might cost me more time or more money down the road. When you're doing that analysis of those of that data, you also want to take a look at any gaps that you might have, either in the requirements or the requirements to the test, and certainly make sure that you're performing any necessary risk analysis for those limitations that we talked about earlier. Now, certainly by improving your traceability, promoting better communication, and I also think by conducting some timely analysis of the data, you can become a more proactive company rather than a reactive company and rely on ultimately better decision-making capabilities.
Once we've captured data and provide better visibility to our teams, Anthony, how do we better manage these potential risks?
Well, the real problem is, Larry, that with risks, I mean, they're tough to get a hold of because we don't know what we don't know. And I had an opportunity just a few years ago to see Gene Kranz. He's a NASA flight control corps director for the Apollo 13 project. And one of the things that he told us in his talk was that after the Apollo 13 had landed, their later investigation determined that there were wires which were exposed in the oxygen tank through a combination of some maintenance errors and testing errors prior to the flight. And those exposed wires caused a spark, and that was what caused the oxygen tank to explode. Now, I think that we can all assume that that was probably one of those things that they realized early on, that if you have wires that are going to be in an oxygen tank, that there's a potential risk there. And they actually took some time to mitigate that particular risk by having those wires covered up. But as we can see with risks, sometimes things happen, and a risk that may not have been very important early on because we mitigated it may come up again because of other things that we do when we're working with our products. So if you're not careful with managing any high-risk items, you can see that that can also cause bigger problems for you down the road. Some companies use scores from an FMEA, perhaps, in order to determine if something is of a high risk and they need to take a look at it. But you really can't always go by just the scores, Larry. You also have to look at some type of prioritization, because that can be a huge benefit to your organization. You know, if an item with a high risk score, is that really that important to the user? You might have something based on the formulas that you use that has a high risk score, but it might be one of those features that's not really important to the user or the customer, which would mean you're wasting time or money by working on that as opposed to some other item. In the case of the Apollo 13 and the risk of fire due to exposed wires, was that was mitigated previously, but unfortunately due to some of the maintenance that was done prior to the flight and testing errors and looking at that information, it ended up being a higher risk item than what it was originally reported to be. Now, every company wants to eliminate risks. We all do. But as we've discussed today, eliminating risk is not easy. And I think with any risk mitigation strategy, you should provide some type of evidence to ensure that you've taken all the steps to mitigate that particular risk. That's certainly going to be important if someone comes in and wants to do an audit, or if you're trying to prove that to a stakeholder. So if risks or limitations are known and acceptable, sometimes things may still ship. It just means that you may have a more limited market that you're shipping to. It also might mean that in order to mitigate some of those items, you may have to have additional documentation or labeling on your products before those are shipped out. Now, certainly at the end of the day, we all have to make compromises, but we can't always eliminate all the risks or the limitations. So you have to make sure that you're managing those risks based on informed decisions rather than guesses and feelings.
And our final takeaway today, since we have better data, greater visibility and risk control, how should we communicate or share these metrics?
Well, most people would think that Word documents in Excel would be enough. And sometimes it might be. Most of the time I would say that it's not. And for some people that are using other systems to work with, if those systems can't talk to each other, that's not going to be enough for you as well. A static report doesn't answer the bell. It's at best, that's going to contain old data, and it's almost always going to be disconnected from the information that you're dealing with. Now, that could be part of the answer, because there are some environments that you're in where you, for either operational reasons or government agencies or either different standards that you have to meet, you have to provide some type of static report in order to meet those requirements. But the big thing here is that if you're not integrating this into your daily activity, you really don't know how those changes are going to affect what it is that you're doing. Your teams won't buy in if they think that you're just collecting data and not allowing them to leverage that. So some companies or management, it's believed that they use these really secret spreadsheets with all of these macros in them in order to make those decisions for users, and that really doesn't work. The big thing that we want to do with these metrics is we want to make sure that we share those, because when we're sharing the metrics, one of the things that we're going to get from that is the ability to have some accountability on our projects. And that's going to be based on conducting analysis on the guidelines and processes to make sure that all of those are being followed by the members of the team. You can also use these to identify any bottlenecks. And this is not just bottlenecks with team members. And I think when we talk about bottlenecks, that's one of the first things that comes to mind. But it could be a particular component that you're dealing with that might be holding up the development process. And using tools can help you to identify those as well. And finally, you also want to be able to, and this is maybe the most important, to track any compliance and objective items that you may have imposed upon you, and be able to defend those in the case of an audit or if you're seeking some type of market approval. Now, in the military, we have a term called OODA, loop, and that simply means to observe, orient, decide, and act. And I'm going to shorten that for us, because all we need to do is observe, decide, and act. And the thing that we want to make sure that we do with our metrics is to make sure that we are able to do that in a faster manner, and also to see what's going on and then make an informed decision on that information.
So tools, you know, we've kind of alluded to that. Tools and software alone will not solve everything, but it should help support your risk, data collection, and traceability strategies. Anthony, can you recommend best practices to implementing some of these key takeaways we just discussed?
Well, the big thing, Larry, you know, we talked a lot about collecting data and doing some analysis of that data. And one of the big things that you need to be looking at is we don't want to do so much analysis on the data that we can't make a decision. So as you're collecting that data, you want to make sure that it's the data that you're collecting is able to get you to make a decision as quickly as possible. You also want to make sure that you keep things connected. When we talk about collecting that data and working with it step by step, making sure that our requirements are connected to our detailed requirements and connected to our tests, all of those steps that we take in order to do that is going to take the guesswork out of our decision making that we have to do. And it's also going to ensure that we're able to show it either auditors or stakeholders that we've connected all the dots and made sure that all of the processes that we're supposed to be adhering to, that we're adhering to those. And finally, we want to make sure that we have a defendable process. Now, one of the questions you had asked, Larry, is, you know, what would be the data that we should be collecting? And even though there's no real good answer for that, because it's going to be different with every company, you know, I recently went to a conference, and one of the FDA instructors had said that one of the things you want to make sure that you're doing is having a defendable process. There's lots of things that we're collecting, lots of things that we're working on from a company standpoint, and if you're not documenting that and able to defend that, then you're actually doing yourself a disservice.
In conclusion, the perfect product may not exist, but the question is can we get closer? If you track and manage your risks, regardless of what you may call them or how you mitigate them, I think we can get closer. You know, try to document and track them when they're first discovered, not before it's too late or, you know, more detail is requested. And I think that's the big takeaway here today too as well. Provide proper visibility to your teams with the ability to perform analysis, which ultimately promotes better decision making, like you said, Anthony. Mm-hmm. And ultimately it should contribute to better products. We really hope this webinar topic has got you thinking about how you manage and expose your risks, because the reality is we all have them.